All right, welcome back, fans. This is episode 11 of the People's News, and we are shooting from sunny Medicine Hat, Alberta. And I guess maybe start episode 11 off of 2012 with a little cheers. You're gonna finish the Red Bull. I'm on to the gin and juice that we've got going here. We're drinking. I guess this is pink drink mixed with gin. That's what we're doing, and a little bit of Red Bull. You know.
Purple drink with tang.
Excellent.
Cool.
So to start the show off, I guess we got a couple of local things that we wanted to talk about. Roller derby just happened yesterday. I was out there shooting with the team, and there were some big hits in that game. I don't have all the footage edited yet. It's still sort of on the chopping block, but I'll throw up something, you know, for the start of this episode that you can take a look at. But the roller derby is really cool, and it is growing big time. There was a Tigers game yesterday.
Yeah.
So we figured on the way there, you know, when there's a Tigers game, who knows how many people will be there. But the Tigers arena holds 5,000 people, is it?
Not sure. I think 6,000.
6,000? Okay, so let's say it holds 6,000. There's still 50,000 or 60,000 people in Medicine Hat. What are the other 40,000 people doing, you know?
Yeah.
Some of them are at home, but a lot of them went down to roller derby. There was like, I would estimate 300 to 400 people at that roller derby. It was pretty packed. Like, where the last event, I had a lot of room with my camera up on the stilts there. It was like, you know, nobody on the bleachers on that side because there was a camera there. Things filled up to the point where people were like kind of nudging right up to the tripod of the camera, kind of like, is it okay if I sit here? And I'm like, yeah, sure, you know, more the merrier, but watch out, you don't bump the camera.
But
yeah, it was a huge turnout. Sweet. And there were some big hits, and if I can get some of those highlights, I'll put them in there. But it will be up on comtv later, so check out the full game,
you know. Yeah, I can't wait to see that.
Yeah, it's definitely worth watching. Some really hot girls that play that game too, actually. Yeah. Some of the guys I was out there with, you know, when we were filming and stuff like that, they're all happy to be at that event, you know what I mean? Like, so it was fun, a lot of fun. And then the other thing we wanted to talk about was Tongue on the Post Festival. They've got a website up with all the information. It's topfest.ca. So that's T-O-P as in Tongue on Post, Fest, F-E-S-T. So T-O-P-F-E-S-T.ca. And you'll find the venue there. So
I guess it is about that time of year again.
Yep, exactly. We did it last year, like inside the theater. But as I said again, this year we're going to be down at Ali's Ale House, or Ollie's Ale House.
Okay.
That's one of the places doing it from scratch. There's a couple of locations downtown.
Oh,
so
awesome.
Yeah, we've got we've got some shooters that'll be down there shooting that stuff, and maybe get some interviews, and you know, we'll bring some of that local,
hear some good music.
Yeah,
for a couple of blocks.
Bring some of that local music to the community. Yeah. It's always fun stuff we get there. What else we have online here? So I guess that's really it for some of the local stuff I want to mention. Anything else going on, or we get right to stories?
Yeah, I guess. What's your first story?
Yeah, that's, I don't know. I just want to cheers some more of this drink before we get right to the stories.
Yeah,
come on, look at how full these things are. Let's drain some of this. Ah. All right. Cheers to that. And cheers to the first story. Internet wins. SOPA and PIPA both shelved.
Yeah.
So if you are just getting on the internet in the past couple of days, then you might not have heard about this yet. Or if maybe you don't spend a lot of time online, maybe you know, you're just first watching this show.
Went to Wikipedia.
About it before. Yeah, maybe you went to Wikipedia on Wednesday.
Look something up.
Or maybe you have a WordPress blog that you tried to access on Wednesday. Anyhow. The story is really there's these two bills that are trying to go through the Senate in the U.S. SOPA, which is the
Stop Online Piracy Act,
and PIPA, its little brother, which is the Protect IP Act. And both of them basically do the same thing. They're trying to regulate the internet by giving the power to like a very small percentage of people in Congress to shut down websites. And these people aren't even like experts that know anything about the internet.
Don't even use any websites at all.
Exactly.
Like, email, that's about it.
Like, that's the thing. So they might, let's say the websites that they use would be things like government websites and Department of Justice and stuff like that. So one of the big stories out of this was that Anonymous, which is a group of hackers from the web that...
Hacktivists.
Yeah, hacktivists that are doing, you know, all this work to raise awareness, they shut down the Department of Justice website and Universal Music's website.
And FBI.org.
And FBI, yeah. So it's basically... you know, it's not just that some people are going to do blackouts, you know, like Wikipedia, we mentioned, and WordPress did the blackouts so that, you know, they had their site down for a 24-hour period. But, you know, there are hackers out there that are going to go out there and find sites that they feel like are associating with things that are going to, you know, hurt their organizations and just take them right off the web.
Take them right off the thing.
So, yeah, the Department of Justice website down and all that kind of stuff. That's I mean, I think they said their biggest attack yet, and that was, like, reported on the news and stuff, that they took down more websites in a day than anything
they've ever done before.
And speaking of websites down, Mega Upload.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, like, I mean, we should maybe even do, like, let's do a cheers and a quick moment of silence for Mega Upload. Hopefully to be revived from the dead, but, you know. So we observed a moment of silence there real quick for Mega Upload. Great, a great website that provided, of course, lots of content. Some of that content I've heard, I mean, I don't know, I've never downloaded any of that particular content, but I heard that some of the content on Mega Upload wasn't exactly legal. But I never encountered, I mean, I was always looking for,
It'd be the same on YouTube.
Things outside, like, that, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's, yeah, exactly. It's like, you know, there's lots of users uploading to a site, and, you know, now the fear is a whole bunch of people are kind of saying, well, uh-oh, what if the FBI or whatever
tracks
gets
who
that
downloads
list
it
and finds out who downloaded all this stuff, and, you know, I mean, that's just, I don't know.
They can't really do anything, though, because nothing's passed yet.
So. Yeah, exactly. So it's really, I think right now it's like the awareness stage where people are just trying to let all internet users know, you know, even if it's only the top sort of 10% that might understand what these things are that are going on, you know, SOPA and PIPA, these are two bad things that you need to get against and
go against them.
You know, if you could find
nobody
any way
will benefit
to
from it.
Spread the awareness, you know, posting on your Facebook site, you know, changing your profile picture, whatever it may be, that, you know, if you don't have access to
a
big
picture
realm, you know, then just do the basics, you know, let other people that you're friends with know about these things and how they could affect the future of the internet. You know, if a bill like SOPA were to pass as it's written right now, this show would be completely outlawed.
Yeah.
We wouldn't be allowed to do this, right? So, you know, keep public broadcast on the internet, you know, and screw those crazy bills that want to, you know, mess it up for us. Next story.
Cool. So, a top city lawyer is in jail now for escaping his DUI by faking a kidnapping.
Yeah.
So, he was all drunk, walking through the parking lot, then went in his SUV, drives off, gets in an accident, runs away from the accident. When they find him, he's like, oh yeah, I got in this huge knife kidnapping thing, got taken at knife point there, huge battle, and got away now.
Is there pictures of this guy and stuff?
There is.
Wicked. I want to see this post.
Like, that's him all being drunk and shit walking around. Look at this guy.
He looks like kind of a crazy dude.
Yeah.
Francis Bridgman. That's awesome. So, of course, link will be up there, but I'm going to put a photo up there of the dude there.
He was a millionaire. Instead of waiting for police to arrive, millionaire Brigham men set off on foot through the countryside for 3 hours to avoid being breathalyzed. Detectives found his abandoned vehicle and visited the grade 2 listed 1.25 million home he shared with
Waterhurst? Yeah, so obviously that's in London or something.
Yeah.
That's in the UK. I can't pronounce the name of that city either. That's weird. But so yeah, like, he's obviously a well-educated lawyer, though. He probably knows, like, all, like, it said he was a lawyer, right?
Yeah.
So he probably knows, like, all the ins and outs of how those laws work. And I bet even when he's drunk, he's probably like, I have to distance myself from that vehicle. I have to come up with a story as to why I wasn't the one in it. I have to expend a lot. If I do get breathalyzed, like, I might not be above the alcohol.
Run it all out.
He's got to try every little thing. Yeah. So he just made this crazy story that involved every piece of it.
I felt an arm around my throat, what felt like a knife, and I heard a voice that said, keep driving. I was almost in tears.
That's funny. I mean, like, yeah, the things that the, like, rich, powerful, like,
try
lawyers
and
stuff
with,
can do,
like,
to, like, get away with that stuff. It's ridiculous, though. All right, next story. What do we got here? Oh, yeah, the Dutch girl becomes the youngest sailor to circumvent the globe. This was, I think, just a really cool story because...
By herself, wasn't it?
I know a lot of people that sail, and I know a little bit about sailing myself, and I know that 16-year-old sailors generally don't even go by themselves from Canada to Europe.
Yeah.
Generally won't even do much more of a trip from, you know, any end of the coast to south or north. I mean, at 16, you're usually learning with a laser, which is a little one-person or two-person sailboat, how to, like, do turns in a little harbor.
Oh, okay.
At 16, she took this boat completely around the entire world.
How long
and it
has
only
she been
took
sailing
her
for?
123 days to do it, which is, like, that seems like a pretty short period of time. I might have to check with some of my sailor expert friends.
But you wouldn't have any sense of time, probably, like, after...
Well,
like,
no, they've got lots of, you know... I
oh,
mean,
yeah, I guess
you've got lots of equipment and all that stuff. I mean, if you're on your own, you have not only equipment, but backup equipment and, you know, tons
radios
of... And radios.
Radios,
batteries, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm just trying to... there's a picture here. Her name is Laura Decker. She did it on a 38-foot boat called Guppy. And she described it as, she's described as a very good listener. So I guess you'd have to be, if she learned that much about sailing in her short 16-year life, to be able to sail around the world. And imagine what you'd learn, you know what I mean? Just like, because in 123 days, I mean, I'm sure
definitely
it was
able to find yourself.
210-day complete voyage. So that means she spent 87 days at different
places.
Imagine what you would learn in those 87 days of being at various ports all around the world.
Yeah,
you know?
That'd be cool.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Stories from everybody.
Yeah, and there's also a little bit of controversy here. She writes about how the Dutch government was not kind to me. It was never my intention to be the center of world news from the moment that my plans became public. Youth care and other government organizations tried to stop me. So they said that, there were groups in, Dutch groups. So that would be Amsterdam or Holland. Yeah, Holland. So she was in Holland and announced that she was going to do this publicly. And I guess that was back in 2009. And they tried to stop her. So
no,
I guess that's a testament to, like, you know, whatever organization it is or whatever person or whatever thing you think is, you know, the barrier or something that's going to keep you from doing
it.
You can always overcome
it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Anything you want
to
do.
Definitely. Cheers to that. Another drink of gin. Wash it down with some Red Bull. Next story.
Cool. Julian Assange from WikiLeaks has said he planned the Arab Spring. I know, that fly's been flying around all it's over there now.
It's like there's just one fruit fly, and the show starts, and then he just, like, comes out. I mean, he likes the lights. Okay, so Julian Assange, what now?
Said that he had planned the Arab Spring.
Right, this is that Rolling Stones article that we're reading.
He did an interview with him. So the question was, WikiLeaks has been credited, even by its critics, with fueling the Arab Spring. And even Occupy Wall Street. Was this your plan? Do you imagine you could have this kind of impact? His response was, we planned for the most of what has occurred over the past 12 months. It's fair to say that we're unexpectedly delighted that those plans have come.
Yeah. And, like, the thing I was talking about when we started reading this article was about, like, how much counter-information there is about this Julian Assange guy, too. Because, like, after doing the WikiLeaks thing, and then all these, like, soldiers started giving over documents and, like, you know, talking
doing interviews.
Like, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, he got charged as being, like, a rapist in Europe. And, like, the United States
Any
government
way they
wanted
can find
to take him
in jail
treason.
And take him off and spreading stuff.
Anything they can do to get him in jail or make him look crazy or discredit him, it seems like they're trying to do. But Rolling Stones, I guess, to us seems like a pretty credible source. And I guess it was a really long interview, like 7 pages worth of actual writing.
Yeah.
But the interview itself was hours and hours because I guess if you give Julian Assange any type of forum, he's got so much to say. And it's like, imagine what he hasn't said, though, you know?
Well, listen to this last part here, too. I looked back at this in October of 2010. Is the power structure in the Middle East are independent? They support each other. If we could release enough information fast enough about many of these powerful individuals and organizations, their ability to support each other would be diminished.
Mm-hmm.
They'd have to fight their own battles.
Right.
So what he's saying is, like,
like separate them and break them down.
And see how each one reacts to, like, the angry mobs. And,
And now there's something else you said about Julian Assange has some kind of, like, special, death release pact. like when he dies.
Yeah, he has like a 2 gigabyte file thing. So when if he dies, five people, are gonna release like tons of files and incriminating stuff.
Yeah.
On tons of governments and stuff like that.
So it's like that whole like the nuclear option, I think is what they call it.
Pretty much.
Where it's like if they take me out, the next thing that happens is they get taken out.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like if you launch your nuke on me, my nuke gets launched at you.
Yep.
And it's like as a single dude journalist guy who's got some friends around the world that are, you know, helping out and making his organization continue, but you know, if it ever came down to the right people getting a hold of him that wanted him dead, he would be dead.
Then
the next step is supposed to be send out these files, and then everybody will know all these dirty secrets, right?
Yeah.
So you know what the government has to do?
Get those files.
Now they got to kill Julian Assange and then make a fake guy that's new Julian Assange, right? And then they got to get this guy to do
like
some
new
other
Paul.
Stuff. Yeah.
Yep.
Fake Paul, man.
This is it's the new fake Paul.
Yeah. All right. So, local stories.
Yeah, I guess local stories.
Got that Medicine Hat news up here. So yeah, Medicine Hat newspaper was a story by somebody new that we haven't read from yet. Peggy Revel, or Revel is the name. You'll have to write me an email or give me a call, Peggy, and let me know how to pronounce your name. But the story was provincial funding to bring high-speed web to rural Albertans.
And everybody still would dial up, finally.
Exactly. This put a big smile on my face because I am, of course, a big supporter and promoter of internet use everywhere and, you know, everybody sharing information.
Everybody, yeah,
whatever
exactly.
You need to get, you know. There's people that live just outside of Medicine Hat in Cypress County, and the article here by Peggy said that she had found out only 103 of the 148 townships there are classified as having unserved for broadband. So 103 of the 148 townships in Cypress County do not get broadband service and are
They still can't make a call while going on the internet.
Yeah, exactly. They couldn't use, for instance, Google Skype. They probably can't use Skype.
Nope.
I mean, the speed's probably not fast enough. Can't watch streaming videos in high def. So there's a lot that they aren't getting out of the internet, and it seems like the more the playing field is leveled, the better. And the thing they talk about in here is this... what is it called here? The program is called Final Mile Rural Program. Final Mile Rural Community Program. It's a very generic name.
You forgot the community.
Yeah, exactly. But anyways, what they're doing is they're going to bring that high speed in. They got $5 million, and municipalities can request funding of this $5 million. And they say it's mostly going to be for First Nations and Métis settlements. So that they can get access to the high-speed internet. Yeah. So I think it's awesome to level the playing field because, as I said before,
for education,
it's so much easier to do research
on stuff, find new stuff about whatever you're learning in school, and instantly instead of having to wait and load up pages. And, yeah, exactly.
But it's like leveling the playing field where I think something that wasn't level before, like. I think if you ask any Canadian, would you rather send your kids to a school on a native reserve, or would you rather them go to a public school in a city? I think a lot of them would say, well, obviously I want them to go to the one in the city.
Yeah.
And it's like, I think it's just a known thing that you know, the Métis settlements and First Nation bands around Canada don't have the same access to the tools that they have in cities for kids. Yeah. So, of course, the speed of their internet connection is a major factor now because, you know, you can get a day's worth of research done in an hour if you have a really great connection speed and you can get that data quickly. So
exactly.
Yeah, that's an important move there, and I congratulate the
farmers trading grain on the stock market.
Oh yeah, that was another one. Yeah, that they mentioned.
Make it so much easier instead of them having to get a middleman, sell it to them who marks it up and makes all the profit.
So outside in Cypress County and around, there's a lot of farmers and they have large amounts of product that they move on a regular basis, like grain and, you know, stuff like that. And I don't know,
they're constantly
meat and
trying
all that.
To like find people to buy it. So
yeah. So if you have
having
internet,
to go to their neighbor,
and you're using
they can,
it to its maximum
exactly.
capability, then you could be, you know, making more deals and probably finding more buyers and, you know, all that kind of things. So,
more deals, more money.
Yep. And then what else from local stories? There was
Tigers
game
Swift
night.
Current 2-1.
Yeah, and there was a couple of highlights from the game here. I mean, Tigers are always doing well at home. I guess the last four games they won at home here, the last four games period. But the highlight was and I hope I pronounced this properly, Hunter Shinkaruk, collected 2 assists in the game, and that gave him his 100th career point.
Good for him.
Which is a pretty big achievement there. So, you know, he's moving on up in the WHL.
Also, too, a little longest one in the WHL this season. Yeah. Emerson Meadham, 9 goal streak.
Yeah, so that's the longest one in this season for the WHL. So, you know, Emerson Meadham keeping the game together, and you know we're winning big time. So.
Awesome, good team player.
We don't have any video of the game. I guess there's a unnamed local broadcast company that gets all the rights to that, and we don't have access. But we're hoping that pretty soon we'll be able to at least get in and maybe interview players and stuff like that, because there's a lot of really interesting stories that come out of Medicine Hat. You know, like we got NHLers come out of Medicine Hat, like big-time superstars come out of little old Southern Alberta. Oh, yeah. So I think it'd be great to be able to talk to some of them on their way up. You know, when we get the next Sidney Crosby coming out of Medicine Hat, or the next Wayne Gretzky coming out of Medicine Hat, how great would it be to have that interview with him when he's 18 or, you know, 19 years old, just talking about, you know, how he feels about the game of hockey.
What he likes about it.
Yeah, you know, that'd be great. So, you know, we love our Tigers, and if we can get in there and talk to the boys sometime, we'd love to. Yeah. Is there any other local stories we had here?
Not really. It was kind of a slow week here.
Yeah, it wasn't a big week. I guess we'll move back on, finish off with some videos here.
Yeah, huh? Guess I got a video for you. Screaming Marine. That was not a countdown. Let's check it out.
Take down, boy. Can I get out of this now?
Nope.
Have you ever been on one of those things?
Oh, no. I have a fear of heights. I wouldn't do that.
Oh, yeah. I knew that. So, like, does your fear of heights preclude you from doing any kind of roller coaster type thing? Or?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
But you have no fear of speed.
No, I love going fast. Oh, it's fun.
So, like, half of this scares the crap out of you, and half of it you love.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, if I could find something that would shoot me, like,
straight forward.
Straight forward, yeah, I'd do that.
So, these guys are Marines, right?
His buddy's just losing his mind.
All right, so then what's the scariest ride you've been on, then? Have you been on a roller coaster or anything like that?
Yeah, it wasn't too big of one, though. It just kind of went up, though, and freaked me out.
Yeah?
I can't stand heights.
So what do you do in that situation? Do you start screaming, or do you just, like, hold on to stuff? Or
I just go silent and just kind of sit there. I'm like...
Yeah? Yeah. Just kind of, like, try and block it out from your memory and
stuff?
Yeah,
pretty much, exactly. Like, focus on something else. Yeah. Like, yeah.
I don't know, I've always really liked roller coasters. When I was really young, I think when my family was like, I was about 7, my older sister was about 9, something like that. We went down to California, where we had some family, and Disneyland is there.
Yep.
And man, we did go on, what was it called? Space Mountain.
Well,
Space Mountain in Disneyland.
Never heard of it.
We went on it like 12 times in a row. It's like you go in this big warehouse. And inside this huge, enormous warehouse, they have this, like, crazy roller coaster. You know, it goes all around stuff, right? But all the lights are off inside the place, and there's all these lights on the walls and shit. So it's like you're going on this roller coaster, and you're, like, going forward, and you see, like, red lights going like this. And it makes you feel like you're going way faster because there's these red lights going by. And then it looks like the red lights go up that way. And then all of a sudden you hear this noise, like, and then your train just, like, drops down and goes somewhere else. It, like, it's so freaky, but, yeah. Did that a lot when I was younger, so I don't know. Like, I will get motion sickness if stuff is like too perpetual, like rocking back and forth or just going around in a circle, like making you dizzy. Then I can get motion sickness from that. But otherwise, I don't mind roller coasters so bad.
Like, yeah, I don't mind going up and down like that or spinning around. It's just the hype part. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's something we have to overcome during this show.
I went to Calgary Tower, and I went on the glass there, and I looked down.
And so did that help?
Yeah, oh, yeah, definitely. Like,
because people say you gotta overcome your fears.
I stood there, looking down. Oh, that was, yeah.
And that's like a couple thousand feet, right? That's like, I don't know how tall it is. Yeah, look it up there real quick. But yeah, that's what they say. You gotta overcome your fears by, you know, approaching them head on, so going up in the Calgary
626
tower.
Feet tall.
626 feet. So yeah, that's the tallest thing you've ever been up in, I'm guessing.
Yep.
Right? Yeah. That's cool.
Yeah.
See, I think maybe then if you like the whole speed, you know, like you like driving cars quickly, you like, you know, that aspect of it, then maybe roller coasters would be a good way to overcome your fear of height. Because it's fun that you're going fast and you're only up in the air for a second and then you get you know what I mean?
I don't know.
And then you drop right back down. Yeah, that's the other thing too, is what is it about the fear of height? Is it the fact that you're so high up? Or no, that you're afraid of falling off of that thing and falling through the air downward?
No, it's just the like openness around it.
Just the openness, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that might be a born and raised in the prairie type of thing. Or more common to people that are born and raised here, you know what I mean? Like, because where I grew up, there's a lot of places where you're stiff. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of like really steep drops and stuff. So you get used to like the ocean being that way, and there being so much open space and just rocks and stuff. Whereas if you're born in the prairies, there's always lots of ground around you. So like you get this like comfort of you're never at the edge of the earth.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Whereas if you're in like Halifax or Vancouver, it kind of feels like at some spots you're at the edge of the earth because it's just a deadly drop off down to some rocks. But I'm trying to think of if there's any like fears that I still harbor.
Fear heights. Fear of Dalmatians.
Yeah, I know. The Dalmatian one's funny, dude. I don't know. Is there anybody out there with a fear of Dalmatians? If there is, let us know. Fear of any kind of strange, really particular animals. I think that's kind of funny. It's like not being afraid of dogs. Like, he likes dogs. He loves dogs. But Dalmatians in particular, he's like, no, I don't like those guys. Well, I think one must have attacked you when you were younger.
It did. I was like,
yeah.
Five,
so that's why. Yeah. Eh? You have this like
jumped up and like. Oh,
that's being prejudiced. So that's like being racist, right? You're racist against those dogs just because one Dalmatian did something wrong doesn't mean they're all bad, you know?
No. Yeah. It does.
You're just generally against Dalmatians.
Yep.
That's good. Okay. Speaking of dogs, then this is actually kind of brings me to my next story. This was. I guess we better finish these drinks before we do the last story, eh? Ah, that thing's gone. I think I put more gin in mine, that's what I'm gonna say.
Excuses.
Yeah. Alright, so last story. This was up on Animal World's Facebook page. They've always got some cool animal-related videos sometimes. Mostly funny stuff with, you know, cats fighting each other, whatever the heck, but...
Animals playing games on iPods.
Yeah. This one was kind of cool. It's called Track Your Pet. This was, like, a company called... what was it called? Tag. T-A-double-G. And this thing is like $8 a month, and I thought you might be like this because you have a dog, but any pet owners out there would probably find this cool. I'm just going to play this video through here, a bit of load. No, I skipped the ad, so I think it's... some volume here. Check this thing out.
Our 2012 CES coverage is powered by Ford.
I love Techzilla. These guys are great. Patrick Norton.
Techzilla at CES. I recently had
the... Cooperate, YouTube.
Yeah, YouTube is not cooperating well right now. It's like, I don't know, maybe they go through these changes, like they just updated all this stuff on YouTube, and it looks a little better, but it doesn't work better. What's your dog's name?
Opal.
And what kind was it again?
Purebred Maltese.
Maltese. Those ones are expensive, actually, aren't they?
Yeah.
That's like a high-class dog. All right, here we go.
We adopted two cats for Christmas, 5:15 a.m., Christmas morning, the cats escape. 5:30 in the morning, I'm running around with a flashlight in a dark neighborhood trying to find the two lost cats. If I'd had Tag, the pet tracker, my life might have been a little easier. It's a pretty slick device. Attached to a collar. Animal weighs 10 pounds. The collar weighs, actually, the device itself weighs about an ounce. 30 days of battery life. GPS, cell phone comms, and if your pet leaves a defined zone, it sends you a message. Tells you the cat's escaped or the dog's escaped and it's time to go get him. Unfortunately, one of my cats weighs like 7 pounds, so this would be a little too heavy for it, but I'm waiting
for
a reduced version
of
the device.
Cats
run away. Yeah, service. Okay. And if you're tired of letting your dog run away, this might be a good one for you to check out. Hey, one more new product from CES. We got all the best stuff at revision3.com.
So yeah, that was Patrick Norton from Revision 3 down at CES talking about the tag dog collar thing there. Cool. So have you ever lost your dog?
No, never.
Never once?
No, never.
Not even like
nope.
ever? Okay. Well, I mean, but you could probably imagine at least how bad you'd feel if did happen. Is your dog's mostly an indoor dog or
she goes outside, but
yeah so I mean I think it's more common with people that have, like, maybe if you've moved to a new area or if your pet is commonly outside and
bigger
then,
dogs,
you know, maybe something happens, like if there's I don't know, like this explosion out at Suffield or something, like that, something that spooks your animal or a broken fence, something as simple as that, and they get out. That's really cool though that you could have your Android device or your iPhone device and it sends you a message and tells you where your pet's at, so there's no guessing game. You know where you're going to get your pet back. Really, really cool idea there. And I guess the only thing I thought was kind of weird, or, you know, kind of, I don't know, like there should be like a lock on it or something like that, because I'm guessing that's almost like having your dog run around with a $100 chain on, because like if your dog runs away and then somebody finds this chain thing, hopefully they're going to do the good service of returning you your dog, but there's also the possibility they could get themselves a new tracking device. But yeah, pet tracking, I think that's, you know, that's something that a good pet owner should be into if they got maybe a new pet for young kids. And I know Kim Johnston, he started this Facebook page, which is like KJ's lost pet service reporting thing.
Okay.
Anyways, that's pretty cool. If you have a pet, you might want to sign up there, because if you ever happen to lose your pet, every pet owner around Medicine Hat is basically on this Facebook and will try and, you know, help out and help you find your pet. So, good episode, man.
Yeah, good episode.
Thanks for watching, folks.
Cool.
We will see you next week. You gonna do a hat throw?
Sure.
Let's see if I can get this thing on there. My rabbit bird. Oh, you might have won that one.
Hello, I'm from London.